So my name is Andrea Giovannucci. I'm an assistant professor at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and North Carolina State University in the Department of Biomedical Engineering. My laboratory research focuses on computational methods for the analysis of brain imaging data, chiefly voltage and calcium imaging data. That is what I'm going to talk about today. Okay. So this is the outline of my presentation. Please feel free to interrupt me at any moment. So I prefer being interrupted if it's going to help you understand the full extent of my talk. I'm going to go slow. There's going to be a lot of materials because we're going to slow down, a little bit of it cannot be covered. I'm totally fine with that. Okay. All right. So this is my, this is the outline. After a brief introduction about calcium imaging, we'll deal with different portions of the pipeline for the analysis of calcium voltage imaging. And also we'll look at different modalities of analysis, specifically batch versus online analysis or streaming. Right. So I don't think we need a lot of introduction about calcium imaging data here, but it's an amazing instrument. It comes from advances both in microscopy, in protein engineering design. And what they basically, calcium imaging allows you to do is to focus, optically section a portion of the brain and see what's happening there. So you're gonna see a lot of, donuts popping up in the case of neurons, but you might also see dendrites, like in the case here of the cerebellum. And sometimes you can see both the donuts and processes that comes out of these neurons. So what we need to do is trying to extract information. If you take, for instance, the average of a few pixels around these donuts, you might see that the signal looks like that. The yellow marks on the top, they represent spikes. So what we know is that every time there is a spike, there is a change in fluorescence, this neuron becomes more bright, and there is some biophysical, if you want, property associated to both the neurons and the indicators that will give a specific temporal profile to this temporal activity, to this activity. So what we need to do at the end is to try to go from this movie back to the spikes. And this operation, although it seems very simple, actually entails a lot of difficult steps. And many of them actually are not completely successful. So let's talk about them. Second thing I wanted to highlight for you is the difference between two types of images, single photon and multi-photon imaging. So in case of single photon imaging, unlike the previous slides that we saw, you see that the signal is not that clear. Right? It's less clear, there's more contamination, you see a lot of background, fluorescence. So this represents a modality that is, if you want, cheaper to implement and also more flexible in terms of implementation. For instance, you can have freely moving animals very, very easily, but it's also more computationally complex. We're gonna deal with that also later. And finally, I want to highlight what voltage imaging looks like. The movie is actually running, you don't see anything. So what happens with voltage imaging is that the signal is much smaller. Of course, you can improve on this type of movies, but the baseline idea is that we start from a much lower signal to noise ratio than calcium. So, and finally, I want to distinguish two types of analysis that you can perform on data. One is called batch analysis. That means I have all the movie, I analyze all of it, I put it in memory or not in memory, but I have access to all of it, and extract my neurons and my activities. A second, more interesting scenario is the one in which, okay, I don't have access to the whole movie, for instance, or I cannot load it in memory because it's too big. So what I do, I process a few frames at a time, or one frame at a time. This is an online streaming scenario. As you might guess, this is not only useful to analyze big data, but also to develop new type of experiments, closed loop experiments, for instance. What are the requirements associated with analysis of calcium imaging data? So going from the raw movie to the spikes entails a set of preprocessing steps. These preprocessing steps can be defined for calcium imaging, as you see in this top field, in this top section of this graph, but also for voltage imaging. And although they change in some details, we can basically identify universal stages. One is correcting for motion. And it means that we have, the brain is moving and then we have a microscope on the top of it. So there might be a situation in which the pixels will not represent always the same spatial location. So we might want to fix this problem. Then we want to identify where these neurons are, right? What are the neurons? Where are they? And finally, we want to extract the noise, the activity of this signal. And you might think that trivially, I just need to average the pixels of these neurons and to extract activity. But actually, that's not the case. This is an example here. You might see very clearly if you just take the averages, of these neurons, what you get out is a signal that is very contaminated. Contaminated meaning that when the red neuron is on, it will affect also the signal properties of the yellow. It means that when you do downstream analysis, trying to explain or identify the patterns in your data, you might be misled. So the problem we have is to source separation. And if you pay attention, you can see also the background is changing. So you not only have to separate the activity of neurons that overlap, but also have to consider that there might be neuropil activity that contaminates your signal. This, happens both for calcium imaging, a little bit less for voltage imaging now, because we mostly use sparse expression, but you might imagine as the future, as we get into the futures and these indicators and the microscope becomes better, we'll be able to get sparse, more dense expression, and similar problems can be emerged, could emerge there too. But in any case, you have to some lesser extent, also in the case of voltage imaging, contaminations from different sources. So let's go through the steps for calcium voltage imaging separately. In this case, we see what happens when we identify neurons. They're overlapping, as I told you before. So you refine both the spatial and temporal components, you denoise them. And finally, you need to extract the spikes. You need to perform an operation that is called deconvolution. Similar for voltage imaging, you find where the neurons are. Then you have some operations that enable you to increase the signal to noise ratio. How big is the spike with respect to noise, for instance? And also, in the case of voltage imaging, you can extract other properties of the signal. So for instance, an estimate of the subthreshold signal of neurons, right? Which is not accessible through calcium imaging. So this is roughly the requirements for preprocessing step of calcium imaging. Remember, that this data is big. This data, can be maybe 3-4 gigabytes, but it can go up to 700 gigabytes. So we need to be prepared to handle data that will not fit in memory, most likely. All right, so let's start with the first step, motion correction. Here you have an example. Why I want to try to understand why is motion correction so important? Most of the algorithms that are out there, most of them, make this assumption that a pixel will always represent the same spatial location. Let's make an example. Let's say that we want to measure what the activity of this neuron here. Can you see my pointer? Yeah. Let's imagine that you want to measure the activity of the neuron. Let's say we just take the average, right? We stick the average here and see what happens when we take the average as there is this movement, right? I will get a lot of signal that happens only just because the neuron is going back and forth around my mask. So even in the simplest case scenario, we really need to have, let's say, a stability in this movement. So we try to correct for motions. In this case, you see that the motion is not rigid on the top of it. One case could be that I just need to move up and down the movie to align it. In some cases, actually, I need to deform it to bring it to match, let's say, an ideal template. Kaiman, which is the software package that I developed, can do both things. So now I'm going to start telling you about not only what Kaiman can do, but also what are the parameters that are involved in this type of operations. So in the case of rigid transformation, we simply operate a cross-correlation of frames with a template, okay? This is a simple operation. We can estimate, with some tricks, then sub-threshold, sub-pixel shifts, okay? But what I think is the most interesting scenario, more general, is when you have non-rigid motion correction. When you have non-rigid motion correction, what you do, you tile the field of view of, you tile your field of view with small squares, okay, that are partially overlapping. You attempt to motion correct each of them, okay? And at the end, you basically interpolate the motion that you have extracted from each of these squares. There will be some checks to be sure that, you know, sometimes you have a very dark patch and they might just go crazy. So you just want to make some checks. But at the end of the day, what you do, you interpolate the motions of all these squares. And this gives you a motion field, okay, across the full field of view. Then you apply that that motion correction on each, that correction on each pixel. So let's have a look at the parameters that you would use in Kaiman. The frame rate, that is the frame rate of the movie, the K time of your indicator, the spatial resolution that you provide in the input, that's something you know from your zoom level, for instance. And then you define the max shift. So what is that you expect is gonna be the max shift in your movie in terms of rigid. And how big is this? Are these patches that I just described to you? These are the most important parameters that you want to provide. And then tell them if you tell Kaiman if you want to have this rigid motion correction or what we call the piecewise rigid motion correction. Okay, so you have these two cases. Okay, so we tackle the problem. We have a movie. We normally the flow, the practical workflow, we try to motion correct without piecewise rigid. That means rigidly, which is very computationally efficient. We look at the result. If we don't like the result, then we try with piecewise rigid. Okay, and these are the parameters. In general work, but you know, we can talk offline if you want, if it's not working in your case. There are ways to optimize also the parameters, patch motion in Micro. Importantly, is we want to try not to have in memory the whole movie at any point in your analysis, right? Because if you try to load in memory 700 gigabyte, disaster is guaranteed most of the time, unless you know you buy one of these big workstation. But in general, I like running at least some preliminary analysis on my laptop, and most of the time I can. Why? Because Kaiman give us the possibility to analyze in chunk the movies. Okay, so you take a chunk and you analyze it. You turn it in chunk and you analyze it. For motion correction, for instance, we'll see later exactly how this is implemented. But basically what you want to do is to also save everything, okay, in such a way that then is accessible without loading in memory. So is there a way to put my file on my computer in such a way that tomorrow I open it as if it was in memory, but it's not in memory. There is, it is called memory map format. And you know, after motion correction, you know, we do two things during motion correction. We correct the movie, but directly we also create this memory map file that now we can access Visi very easily to read out information of our movie. So let's say I want to plot frames from 900,000 to 920,000. You can, you just load this. Okay, it's open, it's not loaded in memory. You access the frames that you want to load and you visualize. Okay. Importantly, you know, there is a trade-off when you save the data in this type of format, which is you cannot read this file in any arbitrary direction. So reading this file will be very, very efficient if you read one frame at a time. So one, let's say frame from 20 to 50. Or as I said before, from 10,000 to 15,000. But it's gonna be extremely efficient, inefficient, if you try to read, for instance, pixel one, just one pixel across all the movie. Okay? So you say, I want pixel one across 100,000 frames, it's gonna take 2 hours to load a single pixel. So be mindful of this trade-off. And what we, you know, when we, in computer science, this is, you know, that it has a name, of course, it's called F order and C order. So my mnemonic rule today is F for frames. You know, you remember F order, you know, frames. That's what I remember. And then the other one is, of course, C for exclusion. You can remember that. And how actually it is done, this parallelization. The concept is very simple. We launch several processors, okay? Each of them will go and read a part of the movie, process, motion correct it, okay? Generate a template. And then use this template to generate a master template. So example, we take a chunk of the movie, we correct it, we take the mean, right? Then another chunk, we take the mean, and then we take the mean of the mean. That's an example of merging templates. And then we use this final big, very crisp template to motion correct all the other, all the remaining movie, the whole movie again. Okay? So there are two steps. One step, you motion correct several chunks, and second step, you basically motion correct everything with a very, very crisp template. While we do this, you say, yeah, you chunk. Each of these chunk is one computational process, well, it's one one process, right? So each of them can work independently. So we can massively parallelize the analysis in this case. So if you have 200 processors, you can just send, you know, your movie to 200 processors. And this speeds up things dramatically, of course. When we say, you know, each of these processes, again, will write in this memory map file. So the other advantage of this memory map file is that each of the processes can go in and add his own motion corrected section into the final file. Is there any questions so far? Okay. Well, I told you that reading frame by frame is very efficient in this memory map file, but I didn't tell you that actually the subsequent analysis will need reading pixel by pixel. So a second operation that we perform is to transform this memory map file in C order. So in the order that is very efficient for pixel-wise reading. This is also done again massively in parallel. It doesn't take a long time. The only drawback to this approach is that you will find two copies of your data set on your hard drive. But these copies can be deleted, once you're done. So don't worry about that. But what you will have is a memory map, a file that has the name, whatever is the original name of your file, order C, frames, XXX, etc. So you will find this order C file, that is useful for Kaiman to access in parallel several pixels. The syntax, you can see it up there, is very simple. You call a function that is called save memmap. You pass the motion corrected memmap file, a few parameters that are not really important at this point. But what you can do then afterwards is load in memory I cannot see my pointer anymore, just disappeared. There is a point in which you say now load the file. So what you see that you will basically be able to load the file as if it was in memory. You can reshape it, you can access it, but it's not in memory, right? It's just accessible for you. Okay. I thought this is a bit of a more of an interactive experience for you. So I would like, if possible, for you to think about these two questions. Okay. And then, if any of you feel like answering, that would be great. So I'll give you 2 minutes to think about these two questions. What will happen when you have a large area with no neurons and no visible structures when you try non-rigid motion correction first? And what happens if you have movement across the Z? That means if the movement is not X and Y, but it happens in the direction of basically perpendicular to your imaging plane. Yes, you can. Darcy cries. Absolutely. Okay. So if anyone feels like, chatting about this. So first, what happens when you have a large area with no neurons visible, right? So we have this, we're trying to look at patches, each of them, right? Now we found the patch that is dark, right? There is no landmark. What will happen?
Will it try and fit noise, or is this after you run Jerome's denoising on?
No. That's it. It will just go crazy, right? Yeah. It will not, if there is not a landscape, then any solution, a local minimum, will attract, the solution, and it's become messy. Yeah. So that's why we have some control mechanism in place to avoid this to happen. So when we What we do basically is that when we see that the whole, let's say the rigid shift is, you know, 5 pixels in, you know, let's say in this direction, if we find one of these, you know, crazy patches that go the opposite direction, 3 pixels, we say this is definitely wrong. So basically, we have some checks on the fact that this, all these patches should follow, let's say, roughly the average of the other pixels. So, and what do you, what happens when you have motion across the z-axis? And I think Darcy is right, you cry. So basically what you want to try to do, you know, there are some algorithms out there that are trying to approximate, but there's always an approximation, what happens in between these planes. But consider that the information is lost, it doesn't exist anymore, right? If you go up, let's say 5 microns, now whatever was at the plane underneath is unknown to you, right? So you can try to interpolate, of course, but that information is lost. So it's very important to, you know, think as you're doing an experiment, I do motion correction later. It doesn't matter if it looks like soccer. No, to fix it, because that's the most important thing you can do during an experiment, stabilize your preparation. Okay, let's see if I can go. Okay. So now we're gonna start talking about the processing of 2-photon imaging data. So I anticipated to you before that the solution, the underlying computational problem is not just taking the average of a segmented neuron. That doesn't fly in this case, okay? So what do? We use some machine learning approaches, unsupervised, that actually, you know, are very convenient for this type of model. The model is called non-negative matrix factorization, constrained non-negative matrix factorization. And the basic idea is to represent a movie Y as the sum of many different components. Each of these components will represent the space, okay? So spatial footprints, neurons, for instance, and time, the temporal components associated with neurons, the fluorescence traces. So we'll have a set of components who represent neurons themselves that we call AC. And then we have another set of components which represent contaminations from the background. So if you have dense expression, you might have a lot of processes running by, yeah, that might create some fluorescence, extra fluorescence that will end up contaminating your signal. So you try to remove it. The mathematical formulation, if for those of you that are interested, the aficionados, as Caspar said before, the aficionados know that this is basically trying to minimize the difference between Y, the original raw data, minus a product of a few matrices, okay, with the constraints that the sum of these matrices are sparse, A represent neurons. So if you look on the top here, the neurons, they only occupy a very small portion of the field of view. So the sparsity assumptions say, okay, look for stuff, but this stuff mostly should be zeros, you know, a few ones here and there. And that's exactly what happens here. You have a small region of, right, ones, or let's say non-zero elements, and then all the rest is black. Plus the non-negativity assumption. The non-negativity assumption is crucial. I don't have time here to go into the detail of it. But basically, non-negativity is actually what helps you separating the activity from overlapping neurons. Because the assumption of the non-negativity, which tells you that you can only sum contributions in each pixel, but not subtract them, okay? That constraint is really what tells you, okay, no, I need to separate them. And it's a sum of multiple things. It's not, I'm not allowed to subtract fluorescence from one component to the other component. More clearly, what it looks like. So this is a movie, an original movie. We flatten it. So we start from 60 pixel times 80 pixels times 2000 frames, to just number of total pixels times number of frames. And we try to represent this matrix as the product of much, much thinner matrices. Much, much thinner matrices, but these matrices have high degree of structure in them. For instance, if you look at one column of matrix A, which is represented in red here, A1, and we reshape it to the shape of the original movie, actually what appears is a neuron. Interesting. Just the solution of this optimization problem, okay, with some constraints and tricks, yes, but the basic solution of this one actually brings me to identify neurons, okay? If you look at one of the rows, of C in blue here, naturally it extracts the activity of this neuron, the fluorescence of this neuron, which is beautiful. But why is this happening? Didn't I tell you at the beginning that we would represent the movie as the sum of multiple components? Okay, that means that I can reconstruct the movie with just one component. But that's exactly what happens here on the right. So if you do the outer product of these two vectors, we actually reconstruct the original movie containing only that neuron. Now maybe you start to have an intuition why it's actually very useful to separate activity from overlapping neurons. For the background, something similar happens. If you now look at the background on the right, you'll see that if you reshape it as the original movie, you have actually a very, very crisp version of the average, if you want, of the movie. It's denoising, actually, the movie. And when we look at the temporal components, it's also oscillating out. So you can also reconstruct, very nice, you can reconstruct only the background. So I'm interested in seeing what was the effect of the background. Now, there is an important caveat in this model. The important caveat is, you know, the background shouldn't contain many, many components, right? How do I tell the model what is a neuron and what is the background? It's very difficult, right, to say something like that. The difference between the two components is that, you know, the components in A and C, A specifically, are sparse, as we said. They just localized in a very, very small amount of space on the field of view. But the components in B actually can spread across the field of view. They are allowed to roamly free across the field of view and capture as much as they want. So there is an exercise later for you. I want you to think about what happens if I have a lot of these components, right? But before that, let's look at a solution of the stabilization problem in light of what I just told you. So on the left, you have A, the spatial component associated to the movie, and C, the temporal component denoised. In the center, we're gonna see on the top left, the raw movie. At the bottom right, the movie reconstructed, but using only the neurons. So now we just use the neurons to reconstruct the movie. And in the top right, we actually use everything, okay, to reconstruct the movie. And when we look at the difference between the raw movie and the reconstructed movie, what we get is the residual. The residual is very important. I want you to remember the residual right now because we're gonna chat about it later. But the idea is that everything that you see in the residual is something that we were not able to capture. Everything that appears in the residual is a failure of our algorithm. Okay? So you see that some activity is present in the background, in the residual here, you see a little bit. But honestly, we did a pretty good job in using much, much less data, right? We're using very thin matrices to represent what was the number of pixels before. And in doing this, we also actually extracted something that has physical meaning in the movies, which is the neuron spatial location and their activity in time. Okay. So let's do a small exercise again. Okay, we're gonna, this is like more of an intellectual, if you want, challenge for you. So what do you think spatial components are capturing exactly? Spatial, the sets of pixels with similar brightness, the sets of pixels with similar time course that are correlated, or the sets of pixels with exactly the same time course and magnitude? Feel free to intervene, unmute. So you're talking about the spatial component, eh? Just to be clear with you, A, what we have on the left, is gonna be the set of pixels with similar brightness, set of pixels with similar time course, very correlated, or the sets of pixels with exactly the same time course in mind.
C.
Sorry?
Let's go to C.
It's, you say C, okay. What do you see is exactly C?
Sorry, say that again?
So why do you think it's C? For instance, why it's C and not B?
Same time course and magnitude. I guess we would assume that, like if we're looking at the soma of a neuron, you're gonna expect a relatively consistent fluorescence change at the same time, right? Whereas if you had different neurons or ones not spatially localized, you may have, I don't know, you could have neurons that have similar time courses, but like the magnitudes in theory might differ, right? So you could have neurons that fire to the same stimulus, the magnitudes might differ enough. So,
but notice the theorem talking about each spatial component, so a single one, and I'm trying to ask what each single pixel represents, not across neuron, just within the same neuron. So if you take one of these spatial masks, right, what is this representing? And I can give you actually the result. The result is B, and that's the nice part of it. Because if you think about the neuron, and then you have the nucleus. The nucleus still will have some fluorescence, right? But it's less. There is no indicator there. But you know, there's going to be leakage from the other plane. So what you will see, basically, you'll see a lot of, let's say, signal on the border and a little bit less in the center, right? So they will not have the same magnitude, but they are going to be very highly correlated. At least this assumption, right? This is important. And that's something I want to make up front. This is an assumption. Sometimes it doesn't hold. But the assumption here is that, okay, all the pixels will go up at the same time and down at the same time, although with different magnitudes. Also because the indicator concentration might be different in different portions of the neuron, right? You might have a part that is particularly bright, another one is less bright. But what we know for sure is that they will be highly correlated. So C, you know, ideally C would be fantastic, but we don't have C. And that's why when you look at one of these masks, you know, you don't see that they all have the same values, but actually, you know, have some pixels that are darker, some pixels that are brighter. These masks really represent that. Thank you. And second question is, would it make sense to use many, let's say tens or hundreds or background components to try to be very precise in capturing the background? If yes, okay. If no, why? First of all, it is clear to, you know, at least I was able to convey why B is correct in the previous question. Because B, you know, it's very important that you understand the assumption. So, you know, if you have a dendrite, right? You say that you have a dendrite that turns on, let's say 1 second later. So you have the soma goes up and then the dendrite maybe. The axon that goes 1 second later. We are violating this. This is a model that is not good anymore for constrained non-native matrix factorization. What we want is that, you know, everybody goes up, although, you know, some parts might be dimmer, some parts might be brighter, but all of them must be highly correlated among them. Okay. So does it make sense to use tens or hundreds of background components? So I recall you, the background components is B and F. You're trying to capture the background, right? Trying to capture the neuropil. What happens if I use 100 of them? Anybody feels like guessing what problem might happen there?
You'll overfit the data and start incorporating noise.
Very good. Yeah. That's one. We can do also something worse. We can start absorbing the activity of the neurons, right? These background components might start to say, oh, I am free to capture everything. I'm gonna take neurons. So in order to avoid that, what we do basically at the beginning, we try to fit as much as we can the neurons. Right? And only at the end, we try to fit the background after removing the activity of the neurons. So you need to be very, very, very careful with the background. Because that's a source of so if you exaggerate to the number of background components, you actually might obtain results that are, you know, seriously skewed. That's why normally we suggest to keep it between 1 and max 3, depending on how complex is your background. Okay. Cool. Now let's move forward and discuss a little bit more about the computational infrastructure that is required to deal with very large data. As I mentioned to you at the beginning, we had two steps. Motion correction, that was creating a memory path mapping file that was readable frame by frame, and then a memory mapping, and then another memory map file that was readable pixel by pixel. Now, what I show you is that how to using this latter memory map file, we can actually parallelize seriously the rest of the analysis using constraint on negative matrix factorization. And that's exactly the step we're gonna focus on in the next part. Okay, so something that might be quite self-evident is that solving the problem of finding neurons on a small window, right, versus on the full field of view, actually corresponds to the same computational problem, right? Provided that we take into account what happens, right, on the borders. So if you just solve, let's say, here we say this green square, just look at the screen, green square, the big square, the computational problem we're solving is exactly the same, but I need to take into account what happens at the border, okay? So if I parcelate my field of view again in small patches, and I process each of them separately to find neurons to run my negative matrix factorization algorithm, the only thing I need to make sure at the end to, you know, deal with intersection of these patches. So that's actually what happens. If you look on the right, we have this big tensor that represents the movie. We divide it in small tensors that are portions of the field of view. We send each of them to different processors, either on our machine or if we have available high performance cluster, and we let each of these to be processed in parallel. So as you can imagine, you know, this needs the ability to access the memory map file, right? Pixel wise, above all, right? Because you are selecting a set of pixels across the whole movie. So the second file that we created is useful for this. Now each process, be it on your machine, be it remote, we just need to give the file name, right? What is the square that they need to look into? They can load it, process it, and give you the result. So data is not moved around, okay? Because they need to read what's necessary for them, and then can process independently. At the end, you know, we merge the borders. And that's gonna be the first part of our algorithm. Let me tell you some of the parameters that you need to define. So you have RF. RF is half of the size of the square. So an RF of 15 means that the square is 30 by 30 pixels. The stride is the overlap between these two pixels. And K, and this is very important at this point, is the expected number of neurons that I can, sorry, is the number of neurons that I expect to find in each of these small patches, right? Let's say in this case, you know, we have this patch, the green patch. We can say that at most, you know, you will probably find four neurons given what we see in this field of view. Okay, so you give this parameter. In general, you want to be generous with it. Not super generous, because the more you put in, the more computational complexity you will get and the possibility to overfit. But you want to be generous enough to cover the worst case scenario. Okay, so you say, let's say in this case four, then you run all of it, you will find a lot of spurious components, of course. So let me go through also some other general parameters that will be useful for you afterwards when we run the demo. Okay, so P is the order of autoregressive system. Today I'm not going to talk about this, but I'm going to give you some rule of thumbs. You know, as you all know, calcium is on dynamics. You know, there is, let's say, a delta, and then it decays exponentially because the pumps in extrude calcium from the cell. But the indicator is also on dynamics. So this P simply means if you have a fast indicator and you're imaging, you know, at a reasonable speed, then you can approximate everything with just a delta and the decay exponential, you will use a P equal one. Instead, if you are imaging at a speed that is faster with respect to the race time of your indicator, then you will use P equal two. For instance, if you use GCAMP6, GCAMP, let's say, we're talking about GCAMP8, let's go to GCAMP8. G can paint S, right? Even if you, when you sample at 30 Hertz, you know, it will take some time to reach the peak. So when, you know, your indicator takes some time to reach the peak, then you want to use a P equal to. Instead, if you use GCAMP6F, then you can assume that there is an instantaneous rise time. It means it takes only one frame, you know, to go from zero to the peak, okay, of your calcium transit. So P equal one, fast indicators, P equal two, slow indicators. G and B is the number of background components. We discussed it seems to be one, two, or three at most. Merge threshold, it tells you, you know, how to deal with neurons at the intersection between two patches. You know, we discussed that we have to deal with the intersection of patches. How do we deal with that? Well, in Kaiman, what we do is see if there is an overlap, and if there is high correlation, then we merge these two neurons together, right? Because we consider they are the same. And this merge threshold is exactly tell you what is the threshold on the correlation coefficients between these two traces to merge them together. Then we have parameters that are related to overlap between these patches. K, I already explained to you. G-sig is another parameter that is important, and it is the half size of a neuron. Okay, that means if I expect my neurons to be, let's say, 9 pixels or 8 pixels, then I want to have a G-sig of 4, which is half of the size. If I expect the neuron to be 20 pixels, then I want to have a 10. Okay, we have two numbers because one represents the length across the X direction and the other one is the length across the Y direction. Most of the time, let's say for you, probably like all the time, these two numbers will be the same. And finally, some other parameters that I don't think are central for you now. Okay. An example when we had to change the merge threshold actually was originally one of the data sets from Darcy, which he was doing photostimulation. So what happens when you do photostimulation? You increase the correlation between neurons, right? Because you are actually activating them all at the same time. What we did there, you know, we said, okay, this particular use case, this threshold might be much higher if we want to put together neurons. Otherwise, I incur in the risk that, you know, I have a neuron that overlap. They seem to be very correlated, right? But it's artificial. It's only because they're doing photostimulation. Beautiful. I didn't tell you the kind of difficult size of the story, which is, since we were very generous in the number of components that we're looking for, now we're going to have a lot of components that look like crap, right? Because, you know, not in all patches I will find 4 neurons. I will find, you know, 4 neurons in maybe 20% of the patches. And in the other one, I will just have to make up things. That means fitting to noise, okay? So what we have developed some tools to refine the solutions. These are tools that basically help you to check the quality, the magnitude of the calcium transients, okay, which we call the SNR, signal to noise ratio, or the crispness of the spatial component. So we have noticed that when the components looks very nice, like in this case, you know, very, you know, defined and, you know, looking like a neuron, then the then normally the component is a very, very good quality. Okay? So we're trying to find the quality, and one is the size of the transient, the other one is how good, you know, it will look. And, you know, without getting into details, you know, we have something called Herval threshold. The higher it is, the more crisp the component will have to look like. And finally, we train the convolutional network to recognize what is a good component. And in this case, good components means SOMAS, okay? So pay attention, SOMAS. So we train this network to recognize what looks like a good SOMA. You have on the left, two examples, right? On the left, all of you can say, okay, these clearly look like neurons, right? And when you have what's called non-neuron, that's, you know, that's also clear for you that this is not like a SOMA. So we train the convolutional network with this, you know, type of data, and then we test it. And then what you see on the right is example on the test set. So the convolutional network learned, you know, what is the concept of nice neuron. So these three few measures, you know, help us defining and refining the components that we originally found. So an example on the data sets that you also have in the demo file that I passed you on Google Colab is what you get, right? You know, after running these parallelized, let's say, these parallelized algorithms on all the patches and putting everything together, which is a lot of spurious components. And on the right, after passing through our filters, okay? Filters that only trying to stick to what components are promising. Of course, it's still not perfect, but now if you have to go through, sort through this manually, it's a much easier work to go through what you have on the right versus what you have on the left. Okay, is there any questions so far? No? Okay, so what I would say is that let's take all 5 minutes, go to this link and run this demo file. So this demo file is basically, so you will need to save a copy, a local copy, eh? Very important, because this is my file, don't touch it. You will not have the possibility to modify. So I suggest you save a copy in your hard drive. Okay, and you start running, which is very easy. You just say run all, yeah. And basically we'll go through a set of steps. So since it's gonna take a little bit, I suggest you starting now. And you know, as we go through, I'm gonna explain more or less what this is about. So this is in some sense commented notebook. So you can have a look also at the, let's say the explanations if you're interested. But basically what we do, we clone Kaiman from the repository, we install it, and then we, after importing some useful packages, we blah blah blah, we decide which data sets to process. Okay, so this is made in such a way that, you know, it will download locally on your machine this data set. You can start processing it on your machine, not on your machine, on Google Colab. So in your virtual machine, you will have, oh, so how many of you are not familiar with Google Colab? I think there was already a demo before the run with Google Colab. So you guys at least should be familiar with the concept. You're good? Tell me if you need an assistance on this one, eh? Takes a little bit of time to installing everything. This is just a function that I added so you can plot all of these, all of the traces for you. Because, you know, interactive plots in Jupyter are a little bit tricky. Recently, also, unfortunately, it became consistently slower for me, but I think because I overused Google Colab, and I think I'm being punished for that. In any case, what we have here is the data set. So in your case here, you just want to copy the data sets that you want to analyze, the name. You need to put the full path, okay? Here we created a small function that enables you to visualize movie. Of course, this is not super efficient. Again, you know, it's trying to, you know, load the movie and then save it as an MP4 file and then read it. It's just done for the sake of demo, but I invite you not to use Google Colab in general for your data. You want to install locally Kaiman. It's very easy to install with Conda. So very, very easy. I'm just doing it right now because I want to show you what it looks like. But basically this is exactly the movie that we discussed before. You see there is motion there. So here we set a few parameters that we discussed before. The frame rate, the decay time, the max shift for the patches, if you want to pass piecewise rigid or not, et cetera, et cetera. All these parameters at this point you should be familiar with. We set up a cluster because, as I told you, look, this is going to be very parallelized. How do you do that? You create a cluster on your machine. Create a cluster, and then this cluster will take care of handling all the parallelization processes, et cetera, et cetera, in a way that is completely transparent to you. Here we have the motion correction, which is, you know, running. It takes a little bit of time, as again, because I overused Google Colab, unfortunately. Maybe some of you will be faster. But what will happen here, we visualize the results of motion correction here. Then we'll go over, and let me show you again what happens with the memory mapping. So if you remember here, we had a file that was in order C. There is also motion correction. Sorry, in order F as a result of motion correction. So we need the order C that enables us to read pixel by pixel. So we just use this save memmap command. And here, if you want to play, you can, because in this images vector will be memory mapped. So you can really see what it feels like to interact with an array that is not in memory. I wish this was faster, but unfortunately, it's very slow. Yeah, I think I'm gonna go forward with the talk until, because this is taking a little bit longer than expected. Actually, you can also take the time to make a small pause if you want. Just take a break of 5 minutes, okay? Back in 5, so 3:12. But please try this in the meanwhile. Try to run it. Is it faster for you, or is lower in the same way? So in the same way.
I have a question while we're waiting.
Yeah.
I don't think I ran this exact pipeline, but I ran the CNMFE from the 2014 paper, whenever CNMFE came out, the most recent paper, whichever. And I was running into issues of it not finding any neurons. And I talked to a few people and they said it was because the neurons I'm imaging have very sparse activity. Do you think that's an issue?
Yeah, it can happen. If it's sparse and also very weak, then definitely can happen. So may I ask if you're using the MATLAB or Python version of this?
MATLAB.
Okay. I can speak less to it. Is another person actually developed that one. But, you know, it's a common problem if you have, for instance, some drift.
Yeah.
And the activity is very, let's say, the signal to noise is very high, is not very high. Actually, what happens, the problem is the following. You basically are trying to kind of look at a summary image at some point, okay?
Right.
And the summary image looks at how correlated are neighboring pixels. But as these trees become longer and longer and longer, you know, this information gets lost.
Right.
So in Kaiman, what we did, basically, we are computing these correlation chunks and then taking the max. I don't know what's been done in there. You should actually try the Kaiman version for the CNMFE.
I'm about to, yes.
Okay.
Because or I'm about to try this at least on my data, but that was
the results. Yeah, there is also a CNMFE demo. I think you can try that one, and that should actually, you know, probably help a little bit more. But, you know, let me know if it doesn't.
I also run into issues of where TIFF files are the wrong type of TIFF files. I did not know that this was a problem until I started using MATLAB for CNMFE.
Well, you should ask Darcy. That's not the
problem. Yeah, you see this heavenly glow on my face. So we're working on some of those things. You know, there are some non-standard TIFF files that can be read with custom readers, but not with the default libtiff instantiations or, you know, numpy or image, you know, image PI image or whatever. It's possible to just convert those images to one that it can read beforehand. We're working on some tools to do it just with Python scripts in the output. With regards to the CNMFE, I think Andrea was right on the money about having these online methods that kind of chunk the data as a moving window, as opposed to having the giant script, right? Because as he says, you have a giant thing. If you think the signal, the amount of energy in the signal is very, very low, so noise correlations dominate and it just pushes it down. So if you can have a smaller temporal window in terms of that identifier or finding the maximum, it will do better. I should note that many of these methods can be run in ways where you can supply some of the initialization constraints. So sometimes what I'll do is I'll just like run a max Z projection of the image or whatever, and you'll find, and then you can give it seeds. I don't remember what PC has in, what has it in the CNMFE code base, but those are things that you can try. And, you know, the PC, and I don't know about the Kaiman instantiation of it, but there's various ones, but that would be a way to do it. Or to just send it a small chunk of your movie, use that to find the spatial footprints, and then run it on the bigger data. But, you know, this is a known issue, so to speak, if you have a neuron that only fires, you know, once in 50,000 frames or a few times in many frames.
Yeah, it does. It only fires when I stimulate it. And that's very, very, very low spontaneous activity. So
So that would be a perfect example of like, there's different methods of initializing. So, you know, Andrea can speak more. I'll mention a little bit, but right. If you imagine the algorithm for doing the signal extraction is not the same as the algorithm that does the initialization. So there's many ways you can initialize these algorithms with like starting points for which to start. So we casually say NMFE, CNMFE, or CNMF, or whatever. But what we really mean is not just the algorithm, but all the steps beforehand. But you should think about these initializers can all be tuned or changed, and there's a few different versions of it that can help for specific data types.
Thank you.
Well said. Darcy put it really perfectly. You know, there are ways of seeding these algorithms. Which you can, for instance, you go in image A and you select the neurons that you want and you pass that as an input. That's a way to go about it. If you know where they are and they are clear, that's good. The other one, you know, honestly, there's software out there now that is pretty good at finding cells if they are sparse. For instance, CellPost. You know, CellPost in my hands is working very nicely if it's sparse. It's not sparse. But CellPost can do it automatically. It's kind of a generalist algorithm. It might work for you or not. I don't know. It depends on how clear are your neurons. But that's another source. Not clear, so it will not work either. No. So probably the best idea is to go with Fiji, export the masks, and then you know input those to speed CNMF with this. At the end, you know, Darcy hit a very, very clear point there. These algorithms are very non-convex. So they very quickly converge to a non-local optimum. Okay, so unless you kick them very well at the beginning, they might end up in very weird places. And that's where, you know, if you give the neurons, you know, the algorithm is already on the right path and it will just denoise perfectly. Otherwise, you know, things like what I said before, the background is going to absorb things. Who is preventing it? Nobody. So you really have to pay attention to this kind of stuff.
Thank you.
I'd say one almost nice thing that you can imagine, and this goes into some of the things that Jerome and Caspar were talking about earlier, and Andrea said it as well about the residual is very important, right? The nice thing is if you fit everything except a neuron, now you subtract out the NMF result from your real movie, all of a sudden you'll see high residual right where your neuron is firing, and most of the other things will be near zero. So in some of these methods, even doing kind of multipass, where you do one version, then you look at the residual, and then you find other things, can also work. Again, these are like little tricks from in the trade for when you have data sets that like are particularly hard. So if I know I have an initializer that focuses on kind of energy of the signal, it'll have trouble getting sparse activity. I might do this. If I have activity that's a little bit different, I might do something else. So that's when you start playing with the tools like the ones that these guys have provided with the notebooks, then with that interaction, you get a feel for what's good and what's not and what you need to do to make it work for you.
Thank you, Darcy. You can feel the years of experience under your fingers there. Okay, so let me go through it. So this finished everything at the end. Let me go step by step. So first thing that you do is after motion correction, you visualize side by side the two movies just to be sure that the algorithm did a good job. Okay. So in the case of installing locally, you will have something that goes very fast, but this one is actually pretty good also if you want to check a different point of the movie. It works reasonably, the buffering. So we do the memory mapping, as we said before, in C order, after we started the cluster. And then we have all the parameters that we discussed before, P, right? One for a fast indicator, two for zoom indicator, the number of background components, et cetera, et cetera. You set this up, you run the first part, which is now dividing in patches, right, and running parallel, you will get a result that looks like this, very similar to what I showed before with a lot of, spurious components. You refine the result, okay? I'm going to talk about this next. But basically what you can do is, actually, I'm not going to talk about this list. I'm going to tell you now, the fact that you can now also parallelize on the full moon. Now that you have initialized, again, Darcy put it very nicely. When you initialize, these algorithms are very stable. You need to initialize them. Once we initialize them, now we can solve on the full movie. Okay. And what we do, we parallelize by sections of pixels. Again, okay, because this problem can be solved pixel by pixel, provided, some tricks. So we do that at the second iterations, and then we clean up the data with the quality control parameters that I discussed before, right? The signal-to-noise ratio, the R threshold, that would be the crispness, and then the CNN threshold. And what happens is that what you get, you can plot the code again, the components, and see that we actually improved a lot the results. You can visualize pressing play here, each of the components separately, but just, an example here, you can see the spatial component on the left, and the temporal component on the right. You have both the, let's say, just the fluorescence, and the yellow one is the result of the convolution. The convolution is basically the way you find spikes. You can find spikes by applying the convolution, and this, it's not really spikes, actually, sorry. You are basically finding something that is related to the rate of the neurons, loosely related to the rate of the neurons, but that increase the temporal resolution of your signal. And if you did a good job, these yellow trace basically should match closely, but not fitting noise, your data. Okay, so you see that the orange trace here is much less sensitive to these big noise fluctuations. You can also visualize the bad components, the components that were not selected. So for instance, this is an example. It doesn't look like a good neuron. There is a little bit of signal, but depending on your criteria, this might not be a very, very reliable neuron. We extract delta F over F. That is, let's say, a way of comparing neurons across days and also across, basically across the field of view or across days. And then, we can plot the final results after removing all the components that we didn't like it, computed delta F over F, et cetera, et cetera. We close everything, and the part that is, I think, at the end might be useful is to visualize the reconstructed movie. We saw an example before. In this case, we just reconstruct using neurons. You want to see what the movie would look like if we only add the neurons that we reconstructed after denoising. This is not the residual, but one can also plot the residual, as Darcy said, and that might help you to see if there was any issue, you know, across your movie, neurons that you were not able to find. Let's go back to the slides. Is there any question about this? You can try Tom, and I suggest you install Kaiman locally. You use Spider to run your analysis, if possible. Exercise for you. Let's talk about one photon very briefly. Okay. Okay. So, you know, PC that is Peng Cheng, you know, came out before in the discussion, is the one that originally implemented the version in MATLAB. What we did is basically took that package, we, you know, implemented in Python, and we, you know, improved on a little bit on the scalability, and then we added all the features that we already had in Kaiman. Okay, why is it so different from two photon imaging? So first thing, let's talk about motion correction. Motion correction, the motion correction algorithm is looking at landmarks, okay? And as you might see here, the landmarks, they become very blurry. So when you're trying to match two images, it's much more difficult to, you know, perfectly find where they match because it's so blurry. So a very simple trick that works, you know, is adding a bandpass filter. It's a filter basically in space, of course. It's a filter that highlights, if you want, some structures of a given size. In this case, blood vessels. Okay? So if you make it, you know, just passing a simple high pass filter, what we get is this. Now, if we use this one, actually it's much, much easier to motion correct, and it works just perfectly with the algorithm that we used for two photons. So the only thing we need to add is a parameter that is called G-sig field. You can find also a demo for CNMFE in the package on the GitHub repository, if you want. But basically you add G-sig field and then all the parameters are the same. You just run motion correction and everything works as it should. Okay, very easy. But let's talk about neural extracting parameters. There is a small difference in Kaiman with respect to the two photon. Instead of using K, if you remember, it was the number of neurons in each patch. What you can do here is use what's called mean correlation and mean peak to noise ratio. Related to also what Darcy was saying before, the energy is related to the energy of the signal. So for instance, in your case, Arshida, you know, when we look at images, you know, this will not work a lot for the problem that we said. This is what more roughly these images look like, you know, and they basically look either at how correlated are neighboring pixels, courtesy of Spencer Smith, or how, you know, high is the peak with respect to the noise. Okay, so then you can move in the interface when you install Kaiman, and then find, you know, the right value in which it highlights. Yes. And then the algorithm will go and try to extract all these things that you can see in these two images. But why do we need a different algorithm? That's really the big, big question. You say, well, why do we need a different algorithm? This is an example of a simulation in which we basically add the background that might look like the one that is generated by one photon. The really big, big, big issue here is that the light, one photon image, which comes from a single plane, and in one photon image, naturally comes from a chunk of tissue. So everything that happened in that chunk of tissue, you're gonna suck it up. And sucking it up means that instead of having something that looks like on the right here, you have something that looks like this. What do you think really is the limiting problem there? The background, right? It's just a question of background. The neurons are the same. Like, what changes the background? Can we remove this big fluorescence from the movie? And the answer is that yes, but then you need to pay a computational cost. So there is a model, you know, it's based on an autoregressive spatial model, but you know, these big words, the small word is you basically take the weighted average of values that are far from the center of the neurons, okay? and that gives you the value of the bag. Now, the idea is that it's something local, okay, in some sense, and, you know, it's not related to the activity in the center of the neuron. So you take something outside. So you solve an optimization problem. It is much, much larger, okay? But, you know, you have something much, much more powerful that now can capture this background. I have an example later to show you. How much can you push the low rank background and, you know, can it really capture this background? There are a few parameters that, you know, might want to set for single photon imaging, but I'm not going to go over them because, you know, if you look at the demo, they're pretty nicely explained. And they just, it's a way to say, you know, just use this model of the background versus what I had before. And that's it. That's the meaning of the parameters. Okay. This is an example of what happens basically when you use this complex version of the background versus just the rank one NMF. What does it mean, rank one? Rank one means just use one component for the background. If you just use one component for the background, look how much noise, how much issues and contamination you see in this signal. Yeah? So I also try to say, okay, maybe I put 8 components or 12 components. And if you look at the difference, you know, between the background computed with the autoregressive model and the background computed with a low rank representation, you know, you still see that there is something that is not captured. And I cannot even use 12 components because what we discussed before, if I start using 12 components, I'm gonna start taking the activity of neurons. I'm gonna start, you know, stealing activity from neurons or fitting noise. So no matter how many components, there is always something else because we need a more powerful model for the background. And the price that we pay is basically scalability, okay? We have a similar process. So once you understood what we did with two photon imaging, with one photon imaging is very similar. You know, you basically run on these patches, you merge, and then you select the components that are more promising by using different filtering parameters, okay? Use parameters on the signal to noise ratio as we did before, the R value, that was, if you remember, the crispness of the mark. These all work, but and now in this exercise, I want to ask you, you know, I have some question for you, and I want to also, you know, use it to introduce an important, you know, point about the analysis of one photon versus two photon. So first, how do we decide whether to use CNMF versus CNMFE? That's the question. How would you decide? Come on, be brave.
I mean, whether you used an endoscope or not, right?
Sorry?
That's whether one, you use an endoscope,
right?
Or not.
An endoscope? Yes. But, you know, you might have contaminated signal even without an endoscope. Every time your background is big and complex, then you use CNMF, right? That's then, you know, you might even have data with endoscope that you don't need it with. Maybe a very, very sparse expression, and maybe you might not need it even with an endoscope, right? It's really when your background becomes complex. Okay, it's very easy to see in movies. Okay, this is a more difficult question. CNMFE is much more computationally expensive and memory consuming than CNMF. Can you have a guess of why this happened? Let's go back to the model. This is the model. So B is the background, and the background is the whole movie. Sorry, the whole. So W matrix is the one we need to find, okay? And even though, you know, there are not many coefficients that are zero because W will only represent this annulus around the neuron, in any case, the matrix W is number of pixels by number of pixels. So it's the equivalent of a let's say 512 movies, 256,000 frames. Okay, that's the number of how big that matrix is. Although, you know, only few elements are non-zero, but that's why this is, you know, a very difficult computational problem. Before, we were dealing by number of pixels. That's it. Now we are number of pixels squared. Okay. And finally, how would you adapt the algorithm that also uses this convolutional neural network during component evaluations? And relatedly, why can't we use it? Why can't we use the convolutional neural network algorithm? Think about it. So we train the convolutional neural networks on two photon imaging data. Okay, and we use it on two photon imaging data. Why can't we use our one photon imaging data? Do you think the neurons will look the same? They don't. They look blurry. You know, you don't see really these very nice shapes and dendrites, or rarely you can see it. It happens, but it's very rare. So what happens is that, you know, you trained an algorithm to recognize something, you know, which is very nice and crisp and clear, and then you pass these crap components, you know, it's not going to recognize it. So the only way to adapt this algorithm would be to retrain these convolutional networks. But now you have to give example of what looks like a good neurons or not a neurons, but now using one photon imaging components. Okay, so this doesn't work, and it's not an option that we put by default, because it would actually not generalize well across the domain, as they say in convolutional in machine learning. Okay, now let's switch the gear and talk a little bit about voltage imaging and voltage image data analysis with VolPi. VolPi is part of Kaiman. Okay, Caspar also is of course, I've been heavily involved, as I've been, in VolPi. And, you know, it's a pack, it's the first, you know, to the best of our knowledge, it was the first, you know, large scale package for the analysis of calcium, of voltage imaging data. Okay. So let's start with an example of movie voltage imaging. As I showed you before, this is an example of raw voltage imaging data. You know, we can do some tricks, you know, we remove the baseline. And we look at activity, you see some flashes here and there. And when you compare with the, you know, the signal to noise ratio of calcium imaging, yeah, we really are far, right? So obviously we needed to develop methods that were more sensitive than to the signal to noise ratio. Huh? And we want to use voltage imaging, you know, because we have access to the membrane potential, because we have sub milliseconds time resolution, depending on the indicators, of course. And because we can ask questions related to the synchrony, network dynamics, et cetera, with much more precision. Okay, but there are open challenges. You know, only on photon for now. For now, I'm not even sure. For now, that Caspar probably will tell us. And then low signal to noise ratio. That's still the case. You know, although we are getting better and better, still not comparable with calcium imaging. You know, we recently acquired the ability to, you know, look at many, many neurons at the same time with voltage imaging. It's an example of Voltron, for instance. You see that, you know, you get beautiful traces for many neurons at the same time. You can extract single spikes. You can also extract a little bit of subthreshold oscillation, right? Great, great, great tools. So what is the analysis pipeline and how does it differ from calcium imaging? The analysis of calcium imaging, voltage imaging is actually based on the assumption now that the expression is sparse. So let's say that we have sparse expression. We have a few neurons in the field of view. What we did, we trained the convolutional network to basically segment automatically neurons. This might, you know, also probably be applied to calcium imaging in the future. We didn't do it. But you can recognize neurons. It will tell you, you know, the shape, the probability of being a neuron. From there, then what we apply is denoising algorithms that basically goes back and forth between the trace and the spatial footprint and refine them with the goal of maximizing the signal-to-noise ratio in some sense. And at the end, we threshold and extract the spike. So importantly, motion correction and memory mapping are going to be exactly the same as calcium imaging, okay? with the caveat that you might want to use from time to time the G-Sig field that we said before. You know, this is one photon imaging, so if you want to make it a little bit less blurry and more crisp, you can do is just use that bandpass filter that will make neurons crisper. But you know, we found it actually most of the time it was just it worked just out of the box. It will create your memory mapping file, and you are free to use it afterwards to continue the rest of the nice pipeline. The segmentation takes as input both the correlation image and the mean, and will spit out that the neurons. The architecture that we relied on is very basically known in the area. It's called MASCAR-CNN. It is basically two pathways similar to the vision, if you want, system for us. You know, you have a path that is the where and one that is the what. So one that tells you which class are you looking at, if it's neuron or background in this case, and one that we try to segment. First, basically build a bounding box around the neurons and then trying to segment it. Or we can use semi-manual segmentation. So we have a GUI, which in the case of voltage imaging is kind of convenient because normally how many neurons do you have there? 50, 60, that top. So actually it's not a big job to go there and select one by one manually. This we can skip, it's not super interesting right now in the interest of time. And also this one, we just analyzed a few data sets. And what we found is that basically the performance of the segmentation is not far from humans, okay? So we basically are reasonably close depending on, of course, depending on the difficulty of the data. In some cases, like the one on the right, segmentation, the HPC, the hippocampus on the right, you see that segmenting neuron is actually very challenging because they are very blurry. In other cases, much much simpler, like in the case of L1. But you know, this is just to prove that, you know, it was working kind of nicely. And otherwise we have the manual segmentation GUI, which you click on a neuron and it will automatically generate for you an approximation of the shape of the neuron. The only parameter you want to set is the approximate max and mean radius of the neuron that you're trying to find. Very similar to actually something called the cell magic wand, and you can find it in MNJ. Fantastic. So how does trace denoising and spike extraction work? So first, you know, the important assumption is that we are taking our neurons that, you know, are reasonably isolated from each other most of the time. So we take a context region around the neurons. We I pass filter to remove trends that are often generated because of photo bleaching. So we try to have a trace that is as flat as possible, but without of course removing sub-threshold signals. Then we use SVD and rich regression to try to remove from the signal the contribution from the background. Something, you know, along the line of what we saw before, right? Removing the activity of the background from the activity of the neuron. Then we detect a set of spikes, grossly some spikes, using an adaptive thresholding method, and we compute a template. If you ever done electrophysiology, very similar to what you create the templates for finding spikes in electrophysiology. So very same, we compute a template, and then we apply basically a white and match fit. Okay, that means, you know, we apply let's say in the template, okay, in a way, you know, that will minimize the effect of noise. Once we, what we find, of course, is like you see in F here, is a threshold that is much in general higher peaks and more defined. Now you use this other signal to improve, if you want, the shape of the spatial filter. Okay, you take your spikes, you know, reconstructed spikes, if you want, right? You have these deltas. You try to reconstruct using the template a denoised version of your trace, and you use this denoised version of the trace to actually improve on the spatial footprint. Okay, so you go back and forth, space time, a couple of times until you converge to an estimate that doesn't change much. And this is an example of what it looks like. This is the reconstructed movie. Sorry, this is the, on the left, the original movie, the movie with the background subtracted, and now the movie that we reconstructed with our denoising approach. So you might see that now that the spikes appear very, very quickly. Beautiful. We showed on a few data sets that also the performance of detecting spikes is actually pretty good, even compared with other state-of-the-art algorithms. The spike extraction parameters are there is another demo that you are free to look at. I just showed you one of the demos, but all is part of the same package. So a lot of the logic repeats. You know, the only thing I would invite you, if you're interested in the analysis of voltage image, that you look at the corresponding demo to start with. Given the what I just told you so far, it should be easy for you to understand what these parameters mean. Okay. I'll say let's go to online analysis. First, a motivational slide. So imagine that you are recording from, let's say, with two photon imaging, a field of view. Why would you want to have access to the activity of each neuron in real time? So I can see a set of possible scenarios. One is to control neuroprosthetic arms. For instance, you want to control neuroprosthetic, you need immediate access to the activity of neurons. Right? Another one, if you're doing closed loop experiments, like Nicolas Pegard and Darcy, we'll explain about tools like holography or spiral stimulation to elicit activity in neurons. So if we are able to know what's the brain state at the given time, it can be prove very useful if you want to modulate the activity of the brain. Secondly, you might have an experiment that depend on the state of the brain of the animal. Let's say if I want to maybe deliver stimulus, a light stimulus to the animal only when the brain is in a particular state. You need to have access to the activity at each time point, okay? So that's one. The other one is, big data, right? Now, sometimes people reach out to me, I have an experiment that is running 24 hours. Of course you cannot, analyze something that runs for 24 hours, without an online approach. So at some point online might become a necessity because, you don't have the means to really the ability to process the extreme of 24 hours of data, okay? But also, and this is something we're working on, is I want feedback on my experiment. If you remember electrophysiologists, they were able to listen to the activity of neurons while we're doing an experiment. With imaging modalities, we are losing this touch, with the experiment, the feedback. What's going on? I opened the tent, And I see that there is the reaction in the mouse. That's very interesting. Let me study this. We are losing that, right? We need a feedback on what's going on the experiment. So I think that's another important motivation for pushing online analysis. Okay, what are the requirements that we have for online analysis? What are the requirements that we have for online analysis? So motion correction, as before. Source separation, we still need to separate neurons that are overlapping. But, there are other things. If you think about, data sets like the one we Arshida mentioned before. If you have a neuron that is only active once per day, right? You will need to be able to find these neurons in an online analysis. Okay. So if a new neuron appears, you want to be able to incorporate it. And another one is tracking the shape of the neuron, not only because they might change on a very, very long experiment, but also because you might want to increase the the quality of this component, right? Let's say that the neuron fires once. If the neuron finds once, I will have a very approximate shape. But if it then fires 3, 4, 5 times, I want to be able to accumulate information and refine this component. So all this, of course, needs to happen at a very, very fast rate, 30 to 100, 10 megabyte per second. And at the end, this is video process, okay? So we're talking about 30 milliseconds to take decisions. So this is a pretty short amount of time given the amount of data we receive. So this is roughly the way this works. You take a few frames, 1,000, 500, to initialize your algorithm. And then one by one, you do motion correction. Okay, I invite you to check the papers if you're interested in them. And then what we are focusing on today, you know, estimate the spikes, that is basically separating the signals, finding new neurons, and update the shapes. And finally, you will have access to the activity and neural location at the current frame rate, at the current frame. And you can use it to any prosthesis to see what's going on in your experiment, et cetera, et cetera. Even do, you know, dimensionality reduction plots if you want. You can do that in real time too. Let's get out of the way. You know, this is an example of deconvolution. So we go back to what was deconvolution. This is exactly what deconvolution does. You know, it cleans up your signal on the one end, and on the other end, if you look at what's called spikes underneath, it's not really spikes. Let's remember that. But basically, it increases the time resolution of your signal. You know, it tries to go back from the messy calcium signal to something that is more precise in time. Right? And there are algorithms that can do this online. You know, I invite you to read this paper if you're interested. For the sake of today, I would just say that they can be just directly incorporated into Kynman. We didn't need to do anything to do so. I'll tell you more. These online algorithms are the ones that we use by default, even when we do offline analysis. So they're pretty reliable. Cool. So how do we estimate spikes? So the situation is the following. I found a set of neurons here that are my A components. There's temporal components, and in this orange band, I start my online experiment. I say, okay, let me start my online experiment. I want to fit neurons, and I want to find new neurons if they exist. Okay? So what do we do? It's very easy. What you want to solve is a problem to basically fit each frame with the neurons that you know. It's a non-negative least square problem, very easy to find, very easy to solve. What I would like you to focus on is on the residual. Okay, so we fit everything that we know so far. Okay? We found the neuron. What the residual should look like if we do the good job? Noise. If we did a good job, it should look like noise. And that's exactly what we exploit to find new neurons. So we solve this demixing problem. Very easy. It's a non-negatively square. I can tell you detail if you want. And then we check the residual. So if in the residual we find something that looks like a neuron, you know, we know that we need to add a new neuron to the list that we had previously. This is an example you have here, okay? You will see there is some unexplained activity in the residual. We'll have an algorithm that proposes several promising regions and pass these regions to a convolutional neural network, another one, that is being trained to recognize what looks like basically a neuron from what looks like crap. Okay? So the residual, the difference, you know, between what we predicted and what's actually there gives us the information to insert new neurons in the list of our known neurons. So once we have done that, we need to update the shape of the neuron. Okay, this is an example here in real life. You know, the neuron will fire once, then it fires another one, and you see that the shape is refined. Even more clearly, even more clearly, in simulated data, you see a neuron is found. It looks very jiggy at the beginning, and then it's refined. All thanks to an algorithm that is called online dictionary learning, and that we basically adapted to our cases. Okay? So summarizing what happens during online analysis, you know, emotion correction that can be done online easily. Then we separate the neurons, solving by a simple problem, given the neurons that we, you know, already had in our list, in our bag of known neurons. And then we, you know, eventually find new neurons and refine their shape. With the final results of having access in real time, at the same, basically shortly after the frame was received, you have access to the activity of neurons and can use it to carry out either a closed loop experiments or neuroprosthetics, control, etc., etc. This is an example of on a real data set from a mesoscope. You know, the top is the raw data, on the right, the reconstructed activity. The purples are the convolutional neural network that finds new neurons, And at the end, you can see the denoised data reconstructed together with the background. You can run this algorithm on a large scale. What we did, we took the zebrafish data, 700 gigabytes. We ran independently, on 40 nodes, the analysis online of each of the planes. And this is the result. It only took 15 minutes to analyze the full brain activity of the zebrafish, with the caveat, of course, that we processed separately each of the planes instead of trying to, process everything directly in 3D. Okay, now I have a question for you. Can we apply this algorithm directly to dendrites? Anybody's
Sure, why not?
You can even. The problem is finding the dendrites. So yeah,
do you have much spatial filtering? Is that the online dictionary learning? Do you have a basis set that can bias towards cell bodies or dendrites?
Yeah, we have a convolutional neural network. Basically, we propose regions. Right. So basically, we look at the residual, we propose regions, and then only something that looks like a neuron then is added. What's the problem with dendrites? The dendrites can run across the whole field of view. So it's very difficult to find these regions. That's really the problem. Yeah, right now it cannot be applied to dendrites. Or if you apply to dendrites, expected, you have to turn off the convolutional network and, you might have chunks of dendrites that are, found at each iteration. So it's a little bit more problematic. Thank you, Spencer. Okay. I think we are veering towards the end. Let me summarize what we saw today. We briefly talked about the calcium voltage imaging and batch versus online processing and one photon versus two photon imaging. We talked about motion correction. What are the important parameters? Rigid versus piecewise rigid. The parallelization, the creation of memory mapping file to scale up the analysis of data sets. Then I illustrated how Kaiman works in one photon and two photon cases. We went through a little bit of the, theoretical framework of the analysis of calcium imaging, and also understood the difference between one and two photon imaging. But if you want, between contaminated and non-contaminated signals, or so let's say with a very contaminated and not so much contaminated data sets. We digressed a little bit about the analysis of voltage imaging using VolPi. And, briefly at the end, I summarized what we are doing in the fields of online imaging analysis. Everything is now implemented in Kaiman, okay, most of it. You have two photon batch online, one photon batch online, volumetric, we are working on that. It's actually a pretty tough problem. And in voltage imaging, which actually already have also an online algorithm that is, currently under review, but probably the next, next time we'll meet, I'll probably be able to talk to you about that one too. Okay. There are some open challenges to me. Dendritic and axonal signals are still an open challenge. Very difficult one, especially when they're dense. The scalability of volumetric data, zebrafish, scape, data, the light sheet imaging, all of these are very, very critical points to be addressed in the long term. And very long data sets. They begin to appear data sets of 24 hours, which, they become, they raise difficulties, not only at the level of processing, but also at the level of matching neurons, because the brain changes a lot based on the hydration and, other physiological properties. The ease of use is a limiting factor. That's why we have this. Thank you. Thank you, Spencer and Ryan. Ease of use is a problem. These are not black box models. You really need to understand what's going on and to be able to use it. And data storage is becoming a big issue. I'm going to skip on this one. I'd just like to thank for Kaiman, Johannes, and the teachers, of course, that they participated heavily, but also Pat, Suen, Jeff, thank a lot of people from Princeton, Liam, Darcy. And you can find, more information in a paper that we published in 2019. And please also feel free to visit the GitHub channels. Volpa and Fiola, people at UNC, and here Kaspar, thank you, big shot. He participated very heavily, and you know everybody at the Janili at the time, and also Flatiron Institute and Harvard. Above all, Changia and Cynthia, amazing, amazing students. They really did most of the heavy lifting here. And I also like to thank you for the attention. So this was probably very long. I hope it was also reasonably light though. If you have questions, I'm open to answer. Yep, tell me, Spencer.
Yeah, I've got a question about, you had one slide where you mentioned sub-threshold voltage, and I'd like to know a bit more about how you're approaching that, and have you done anything with phlegm time signals and the differences in statistics with phlegm signals?
No, we didn't do anything with phlegm signals ourselves. More children there. So what do we do with the sub-threshold? Actually, it's a very difficult problem. So right now, the way we are tackling it is we remove the activity that we predicted from the neurons, okay? And then we do a little bit of a bandpass filter. So basically, you remove the activity of the neuron and you do bandpass filter. But there is still some issue. So it's still very, very difficult to distinguish, disentangle the moment in which the neuron is going up and spiking, right, for what's just a normal subthreshold signal. And this is even more difficult when they're patching. They're patching, they're clamping and saying, yeah. So it becomes very confusing to know what is the subthreshold and what is actually, in effect that of ejected currents. So far, this worked nicely. My hypothesis that if you really want to tackle well this in the long term, you need some type of Bayesian approach, very similar to what they used in SpikeML, in which you have a model of the background, and at the same time, you detect the background and the spike. That would be really what would work. But so far, it's not validated, but, when we look at the traces, it seems to be capturing, a bit of the variance that is also in the trace of the electrophysiology. Anyways, feel free to contact me. Eh? I'm very happy to answer questions. Me or Pat Gunn, we have issues on GitHub. We try to be fast in responding when there are issues that we can tackle.
Andre, I know where to find you.
<That's it. laughs> Cool. Well, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. That was great. And thank you to all of our speakers this morning.
Thank you, Spencer.